downstairs. I was contemplating speaking in English, and then I came down. Maharaj, in fact, he was at the dentist, but he also asked me. So, you should give Sabla Kupa. Make a look. So, speak in English, and others can listen to the translation over there. Okay. Time is short, so I'll just read this quickly. Shri Bhavacha.
Shri Bhavacha.
Bhuta Bhavana Bhutesha.
Bhuta Bhavana Bhutesha.
Deva Deva Jagadmaya.
Deva Deva Jagadmaya.
Munchayanam Rita Sarvashvam.
Munchayanam Rita Sarvashvam.
Nayam Arpati Nigraham.
Nayam Arpati Nigraham.
Shri Brahma Vacha.
Shri Brahma Vacha.
Bhuta Bhavana Bhutesha.
Bhuta Bhavana Bhutesha.
Deva Deva Jagadmaya.
Deva Deva Jagadmaya.
Munchayanam Rita Sarvashvam.
Munchayanam Rita Sarvashvam.
So the translation is, Lord Brahma said, O well-wisher, master of all living entities, O worshipable deity of all the demigods, O all-pervading personality of Godhead, now this man has become sufficiently punished, for you have taken everything. Now you can release him. He does not deserve to be punished more. Lord Brahma said, O well-wisher, and master of all living entities, O worshipable deity of all the demigods,
O
all-pervading personality of Godhead,
O all-pervading personality of Godhead,
now this man has been sufficiently punished.
Now this man has been sufficiently punished.
For you have taken everything.
For you have taken everything.
Now you can release him.
Now you can release him.
He does not deserve to be punished more.
He does not deserve to be punished more.
When Lord Brahma saw that Prahlad Maharaj and Vindhyavali had already approached the Lord to ask mercy for Bali Maharaj, he joined them and recommended Bali Maharaj's release on the grounds of worldly calculations. These are familiar names. Are found throughout the Bhagavatam. And as Srila Prabhupada says, they reflect, well, not a Brahma's worldly thinking, because already in second canto, or third canto, then Brahma's already blessed that he won't become bewildered by the Lord's external energy. So he himself is not material calculation, but there are many other people, many demigods, and so many others, who in one sense were appealing to the Lord for protection. Now, when Krishna has protected them, they're wondering that, how much does he take when someone surrenders to him and gives him everything? Then is Krishna ever satisfied? And here Brahma is saying, well, you should be satisfied. He's already given you the three worlds. He's given you everything that he possesses. So don't punish him any further. So very interesting. I was looking for this word. Punishment. Nigraham. Nigraham. Vayuryavasu. Nigraham. Nigraham. Punishment. Nigraham means?
To grasp and to push down.
Nigraham. To punish. And that's a very interesting concept, this idea that Krishna punishes anyone. Why does anyone think that Krishna is punishing me? A material calculation means good and bad, that there's something good happening and something bad is happening to me. But devotees, Vaishnavas who are surrendered to Krishna, then sakrit eva prapanoyas. This is a very, it's a very nice verse. You can find it at the end of the Bhagavatam, or it's also in the Ramayana, same verse, practically speaking, where Krishna, Lord Ramachandra, says that from the moment that someone says, I'm yours, in other words, from the time that someone actually surrenders to Krishna, then at that moment I give him all protection. How that protection transpires, that may not fit into material calculation, worldly calculation. Material people see everything in terms of what's good and what's not good. I prayed to Krishna that my sick mother would live and she died. Why does Krishna punish me in this way? Or that I have five children and it's only my husband who was maintaining us and he died. So why does Krishna make such things happen? Now are my children are going to suffer. And there are so many different versions of the same thing, where we see that Krishna's mercy has to be something good in our calculation. And if it's not good, well, then why did Krishna give us his mercy? But that is Krishna's mercy. Krishna's mercy is beneficial for devotees. What's beneficial? So, well, according to Lord Brahma, later on, if a devotee gets all good things, then Krishna doesn't really like him. But if he likes you, then he really punishes you, and then he takes it away. So you better think twice whether you want to go on Sankirtan and become favored by Krishna, because then it's like in the airport, they have the regular and then they have the fast track. So if you want to go down the fast track, then you have to be willing to accept what's coming. And Krishna intensifies things. As he knows what's within, and he knows what it is that, what are those things, what are those attachments that when Krishna Prema catches up with us, then that are going to obstruct us from actually accepting it. Now take it. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur is saying, take it. But then if we don't take it, we need to be able to take it, to actually open our hands and to let go. But I told that story somewhere here around Budapest when I was very young. I went to a summer camp. It was only a day camp, but day camp, night camp, I hated summer camps. And I didn't like to be with others, I like to be by myself. And we went to the summer camp, and I caught a bee, and of course the bee stung me. But because the bee stung me, I couldn't let it go. So I was, I think it's sort of a psychological reaction or something like that. So I was crying, and the teacher's asking, what's wrong? And I was too busy crying to tell him what was wrong. Anyways, finally, so I had this clenched fist, and then they had to force open my fist so to get rid of the bee or maybe the wasp, and then do something about the pain. So we're also in that type of situation. We're here suffering in this world, and we're so attached to this suffering that somehow Krishna has to pry open your hands and make us let go, because we're too attached. It may hurt us, and we may think, oh, Krishna's not being kind. Krishna's always kind. There's no question of Krishna not being kind. It's like the example when Srila Prabhupada, and it's there also in the Bhagavatam, I think fourth canto somewhere, about Krishna, Prabhupada explains, but it's described how actually there's only one energy. It's Krishna's internal potency, and it acts in two ways. It acts spiritually or it acts materially. And when Prabhupada is talking to his disciples, Damodar, then he's also explaining to him that ultimately there's no such thing as matter. He says, Sarva Kava Vidam Brahman. Ultimately it's Brahman. Ultimately it's spiritual. But it acts temporarily, and it also acts permanently. It's a question of how it acts. So for Krishna, there's just one thing, and that's mercy. And he's Yasyaham Anugrahami Parishita Dhanam. There's just mercy, there's just Krishna's kindness. But sometimes that kindness appears to us as being painful, and sometimes it appears to us to be very nice. Therefore, Sukha-dukha-samekha-kra. Don't get too happy. Don't all become overwhelmed by happiness, and don't become discouraged by suffering. These are all really relative, these felt by conditioned souls, and that's what duality needs. Happiness and distress, but there's neither happiness, there's neither distress. It's just how we perceive things. You perceive something to be happy, or you perceive something as being distressed. And then there are many, many examples that fortify that truth. So here Brahma is worldly calculation. Once you've taken everything away from everyone, then why punish them any further? So sometimes judges do a similar thing. Someone is driving down the road and the speed limit is 30 miles an hour and they're driving 100 miles an hour. And they have an accident and everyone in the car dies, all the family members die except for the driver. And the judge says, hey, you've already lost everything, there's no point in me punishing you any further. This person is going to be lamenting for the rest of his life, so what's the point of me hitting him any further? So this concept, seeing, always seeing that we are in Krishna's hands and accepting everything is Krishna's mercy. It's good, it's bad, that's just our relative consideration. When it comes to this idea that ultimately we want to reach transcendence and that we want to enter into Krishna's realm, how we got there because it's a very, very relative affair. Whether you got there smiling or you got there crying, the chances are you're going to do a lot more crying than you're going to do smiling. When you get there, then it doesn't matter. The Krishna says, Yam labdhe cha prema yam manyake nadi kamsito. Once one has actually attained this, then he thinks that there's no greater gain. And whatever it took to get here, that was all worth it. And Prabhupada keeps giving this example all the time. It's like a doctor. And, you know, that was sort of another example. You know, we went to from Hungary, went on a boat to Montreal, and I developed on the back of my leg a boil. And so that was my first visit to a Canadian hospital. My mother took me to the hospital. And I was expecting the doctor to be very nice with the doctor. And he sort of sprayed it, and then it started to hurt. And then they had to hold me down. And I started, of course I didn't know any swear words. I still don't know anyone giving a swear word. But I started to call him all kinds of, you're crazy, in Hungarian. He didn't need any translation to figure out what I was saying. And it hurt. But once it was over, I felt so relieved. And Prabhupada uses this example of time of blowing on a boil. When you blow on it, it gets cool a little. There's only one way to get rid of it, and that's you have to, and it's painful. So you have to live with that pain. So as we go along, we should learn to see, at least with this eyes of knowledge, that whatever situation we're in, and generally whatever physical circumstance that we're going to find ourselves in, which relates to other people who relate to this body, or things like sickness, disease, these are expected things. These are going to happen to devotees, and some of these things are just the price for being in the material world, and they're also means by which Krishna helps us become free from certain material conceptions, misconceptions about who we are. Okay, Bala Maharaj gave everything. Krishna wants more. So he's not interested. What do you mean he gave everything? What did he have to give? what he gave didn't belong to him to start off with. So what have you got to give? So I think, oh yes, I lost my family, I lost my house, I lost my business, I lost everything, well, what else? Well, what's it got to do with you? It's not your family. So they don't belong to you. These are living entities, they have their own karma, they're coming through the material world, and somehow or another they ended up in the same house as you for a couple of days. What's that got to do with being your family? And as you notice, they're moving on to different destinations. So, Bhagavatam gives that example, like travelers. Travelers come, and they're walking, and of course that's not dumped out. People travel nowadays, but people used to travel, they go by bullock cart, or they walk, or they ride on horse, or a horse carriage, and then they would stop in an inn. That's what became a hotel now. But they would stop in an inn at night, and then they know each other. And next morning, everyone goes their own way. You know, that's what family is all about. You just stop for a little while, all right, so it's 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, 60 years, and then we become very attached to those people who we connect with over this short period of time. Mama, aha. Because these two things that Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita keeps repeating over and over again, Janasya Mohoyam Ahandameti, this is the two Ridaroga, this is the real disease of the heart. Thinking that I am mine. And as long as those things are there, Krishna's not satisfied. He just keeps wanting. He keeps taking. And taking, you want to give, it doesn't matter, he'll keep taking. So he keeps putting us in different situations until there's no more aham, there's no more I am anything else other than dasa dasa amidasa. Gopi bhati pada kamayo dasa dasa amidasa. Naham vipra. I'm not a brahma. Naham vipra, nacharanarapati. And I'm no big man somewhere giving orders, not Vaishnava, Shudra, not any of these things. Naham Vipra, Chakrati, not Vaishnava, Naham Gana, not Grihapati, not Vyastra, whatever. And I'm not a Grihapati. I'm not the head of my house. I'm not a father, I'm not a mother, I'm not Gopi Bhartu Padakamayo Dasa Dasa Mudasa. If we really want to go back, and this is what it's going to be like, that Krishna will keep taking Dasa Dasa Mudasa until this is our only identity, aham and mama, and I have nothing. What do I have? Tadira Charana Seva Bhakti. We only have the company and association of Vaishnavas. We learn how to appreciate Vaishnavas, how to see Vaishnavas. Yes, this is my family. This is my family. I don't have anybody else. And this is the same family, either in this part of Goloka, or that part of the Goloka, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, this is my family. With Radha Krishna, this is my family. That's what. And until then Krishna is taking and taking, because after all, we are chanting Hare Krishna. So we're asking him to please take and put us in that particular situation. So, sukha dukha sume kripa lava lava jaha jayo. Summer and winter, happiness and distress. One has to see beyond all of these things and just see that, yes, this is all Krishna's mercy, Krishna's prasad. So it's not that Krishna's prasad is just happening now in 40 seconds, but whatever is happening to us is Krishna's prasadam. So, and prasadam, now is it going to be tasty or not tasty, or good or bad? The only person who has a right to sort of critique that is the temple president, but otherwise, there's no question of good prasadam or bad prasadam. Prasadam is prasadam. It's all good. Is it salty or spiced or not improperly cooked? There's no question of such consideration. It's always prasadam. And there are some devotees, they take this vow. I will only eat Mahaprasadam. There better not be too many devotees to take the vow because it's not that much Mahaprasadam to go around. Either that or everyone's going to get very skinny because we're only going to get this much Mahaprasadam. And so devotees just want to live. I just want to live. The idea is not because I want the great cooking. But the idea is that I only want to live by Krishna's mercy. And I only want whatever Krishna wants, then let them do. So next time something hurts, then just practice thinking, this is Krishna's prasad, this is Krishna's mercy. And the more it hurts, and you think about that, and if you can, keep the balance, this is Krishna's mercy, along with the pain, then you're doing good. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Srimad Bhagavatam ki
jai.
Jai Nitai Bhopi.
Hare Krishna.
Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Maharaj, you want to add something?